Samsung's Galaxy Fold was one of the first smartphones to feature a foldable display. It was revealed to the public back in February, and there was a lot of excitement surrounding the product since it featured a dramatically different form factor when compared to traditional smartphones. But concerns were raised following its announcement, since Samsung didn't let anyone demo the product for themselves, and the Fold was featured very briefly, receiving just 3 minutes and 20 seconds of stage time. This led many people to believe Samsung had something to hide about the product, or that it just hadn't yet been fully developed, which was concerning considering it was supposed to launch just 2 months later at a price of $2,000. So did customers have anything to worry about, or were suspicions about the Galaxy Fold an overreaction? Well, that's exactly what we're going to find out. This is Greg with Apple Explained, and I want to thank Backblaze for sponsoring this video. If you want to help decide which topics I cover, make sure you're subscribed, and these voting polls will show up in your mobile activity feed. Now, I want to begin by clarifying that I don't believe the Galaxy Fold is a failed product. I mean, it hasn't even gone on sale yet, so no one knows what kind of commercial success it'll have. But I do believe Samsung completely failed at launching the product successfully, and here's why. I already mentioned that the Galaxy Fold's introduction left a lot to be desired, but I don't fault Samsung for that. After all, the original iPhone was introduced in a similar way. No one was allowed to demo it after the keynote, and the product was very much still in development. That's why Steve Jobs had to flip through a booklet guiding him through the iPhone's stage demo. It was called the Golden Path, and deviating from it would reveal software bugs that the engineering team hadn't yet ironed out. But you have to consider that Apple was forced to introduce the iPhone 3 months earlier than they wanted due to the process of receiving FCC approval. If Apple didn't introduce the iPhone 3 months early, the FCC would have revealed the product for them. But all things considered, it isn't unusual for companies to announce products before they're fully developed, and that was clearly the case with Samsung's Galaxy Fold. But if that wasn't the problem, then what was? Well, it all started when Samsung sent out media units to be reviewed by various news outlets, blogs, and YouTubers as a way to drum up hype and gain attention before the product's release. At first, things appeared to be going smoothly, with reviewers writing articles and posting videos about the product and their initial reactions, but just 2 days later, several review units began to malfunction, and that's when things went south. Steve Kovac of CNBC, Mark Gurman of Bloomberg, Marques Brownlee, and Dieter Bonn of The Verge all had their Galaxy Fold units break after just a day or two of testing. So let's take a look at what exactly happened to each of these devices. Kovac posted this video to Twitter, which shows the left display panel flickering. Gurman posted these photos, which showed a large blacked out portion of the display that didn't function at all and got progressively worse. Brownlee had his entire display blackout, and Bonn had a bulge appear on the seam of his screen, which caused the OLED panel to break. Now, if you're Samsung, this is one of the worst case scenarios to be in. They've spent years developing foldable display technology and integrating it into a mass production consumer device. They drummed up attention for the product by demoing it on stage, announcing a release date of April 26th, and deploying a media campaign by sending out units for people to test. But just 10 days before the Galaxy Fold was scheduled to go on sale, multiple reviewers experienced serious problems with their units, which caused many customers to cancel their Galaxy Fold pre-orders and vindicated critics who were suspicious of the product all along. And to make matters even worse, this was all happening to a company who already suffered a PR nightmare just a few years ago after a worldwide recall of their Galaxy Note 7 due to exploding batteries. And although every tech company has had their fair share of faulty products, Samsung is the only company to have a device banned from airplanes by the US Department of Transportation. So you can imagine how Samsung must have felt after hearing about its Galaxy Fold suffering from serious malfunctions. They quickly issued a public statement saying, "A limited number of early Galaxy Fold samples were provided to media for review. We have received a few reports regarding the main display on the samples provided. We will thoroughly inspect these units in person to determine the cause of the matter." Separately, a few reviewers reported having removed the top layer of the display, causing damage to the screen. The main display on the Galaxy Fold features a top protective layer, which is part of the display structure designed to protect the screen from unintended scratches. Removing the protective layer or adding adhesives to the main display may cause damage. We will ensure this information is clearly delivered to our customers. Now, that was the full statement, and I want to break it down piece by piece, because Samsung actually managed to put most of the blame on reviewers rather than being honest about their own product's faults. Notice how they framed this situation by avoiding any negative terminology until it could be associated with the reviewers. Samsung said they would determine the cause of the matter, rather than figuring out why their smartphone broke after just 2 days of use. Then immediately after that sentence, they turn it around on the reviewers by saying, "A few reviewers reported having removed the top layer of the display, causing damage to the screen," which makes it sound like the reviewers did something wrong to cause the Galaxy Fold to break. But this isn't entirely true, because two of the broken units still had their protective top layer intact. Not to mention the top layer of one review unit began to peel off on its own after just days of use. So if Samsung had issued a fair and honest statement, it would have read something like, "Our engineering team completely overlooked a flaw in the Galaxy Fold's main display. We will investigate the damaged units in person to ensure the cause of these problems are identified and solved. Samsung customers expect us to deliver world-class hardware, and we will not release the Galaxy Fold until it lives up to that standard." But instead, they deferred blame and threw their reviewers under the bus in a very dishonest way. And if that weren't enough, Samsung requested that iFixit remove its teardown of the Galaxy Fold after they suspected the device provided insufficient protection from debris damaging the screen. iFixit wasn't under any legal obligation to remove the teardown, but they did so out of courtesy to Samsung. And what bothers me about this situation is that if iFixit could tell the display wasn't adequately protected from debris, why couldn't Samsung identify this problem themselves while the product was in development? Now, eventually, Samsung announced that the Galaxy Fold would be indefinitely delayed and all media units had to be returned. This began a period of speculation that continues today. Will Samsung be able to solve the Fold's serious problems? If so, how long would it take? Well, there have been no official statements from the company itself, but according to a recent report from Yonhap News Agency, Samsung has apparently fixed both issues with the device. First, the protective top layer of film will be tucked underneath the display bezels. That way, users won't be tempted to peel it off. Second, the hinge mechanism has been redesigned with smaller openings to prevent debris from falling inside and getting wedged behind the display. And while these solutions may help, I'm not sure they're foolproof. It sounds very similar to Apple's Butterfly keyboard solution. In order to prevent debris from entering the key, a protective silicon membrane was added, which didn't actually eliminate key failure, but rather delayed it. And considering Samsung has only been working on these fixes for about 3 weeks, it's hard to believe they've implemented real fixes rather than applied a couple band-aids. But one thing appears certain. Samsung is definitely going to release the Galaxy Fold. It's just a matter of when. And if this alleged leaked AT&T email is to be believed, the Fold could be released as soon as June 13th. Now, like I said earlier in the video, I don't think the Galaxy Fold will be a failed product. I think it's pioneering some important technology that'll begin a new era for smartphones. But that technology is still in its early stages of development, and the Galaxy Fold is clear evidence of this. Even if its main display performed flawlessly, the device has some serious compromises. It's heavy, thick, and awkward to use as a smartphone. The front display is small with comically large bezels, and the main display has an unsightly seam that's even less enjoyable to touch. Reviewers have noted jelly scrolling, where one side of the display lags behind the other, and even color temperature differences between the display's left and right side. And I think all this reveals Samsung's biggest flaw as a company, and that is their obsession with being first to market, even if it means releasing an unpolished product. They clearly fell victim to this with the Galaxy Fold, but also with the Galaxy Gear smartwatch in 2013. Samsung knew Apple was working on a smartwatch, and they wanted to beat them to market. The problem was the first generation Galaxy Gear watch was an objectively awful product, receiving poor critical reviews and achieving very little sales success, with 30% of Best Buy customers eventually returning it. And all that could have been prevented if Samsung had just spent a couple more years developing the Galaxy Gear's technology. That way they would have ended up with a much higher quality product. Now, that may not be the case with their Galaxy Fold, but things are certainly off to a rocky start. Now, if you're part of the 25% of computer users who don't back up your data, I need to introduce you to Backblaze. It backs up all your computer's data to the cloud automatically without even thinking about it. You don't need any external hard drives, and you don't have to set up Time Machine. You literally install the application and never worry about losing your data again. I cannot explain how simple and convenient this is. There's no limits to the amount of data you can back up, no limits to the type of data. You just set it and forget it. And when you need to retrieve that data from the cloud, you can access it from the web or from their mobile app. But what sets Backblaze apart is that you can actually request your data by mail, not email, like actual snail mail. They use FedEx overnight to quickly send you a flash drive or hard drive with all your data on it in case you have no way to access the cloud. And you can even return the hard drive to get a full refund, which is a huge advantage of using Backblaze. So go to backblaze.com/appleexplained and receive a fully featured 15-day no-risk free trial. Go there, play with it, and start backing up your data to prevent big headaches in the future. Start today. Alright guys, thanks for watching and I'll see you next time.